motto, no matter where you come from or are going, what you believe or doubt, what you're feeling or just not feeling, what you have or don't have, no matter whom you love, all of who you are is welcomed into this community of faith by a God who loves you passionately. Thanks be to God. Amen. Really, just one announcement for this week. We took a week off from our online Zoom Bible study, and we will be starting back on this Tuesday, at 6 o'clock. That's every week. So we are, as I mentioned last week, and this was by request of those who have been doing the study with me, we are doing we're going through the book of Revelation, and I know that makes some people really nervous, and I just want you to know, if you want to join us, everything's going to be okay. It really is. It's not what you think it is, and I always have a good time teaching that, because every time I do, half the class ends up mad at me, half of them end up relieved, and that makes me smile. But also, several people have asked, well, is this about the election? Not. I promise you it's not about the election. Also, speaking of the election, we will later in this service, when we do our prayers, be lifting up this country and our candidates and our president and vice president-elect and our current president and vice president. So we lift up all of those who have taken part in this process. But as we move forward in worship, I think it's time for our first hymn.
First number. Our hymn this morning is Rejoice, the Lord is King. We'll sing verses 1, 3, and 4. Please rise in body or in spirit as we sing together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ.
Christ is only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
first letter to the Thessalonians, chapter 4, verses 13 through 18. I'm reading from a common English Bible. Brothers and sisters, we want you to know about people who have died so that you won't mourn like others who don't have any hope. Since we believe that Jesus died and rose, so we also believe that God will bring with him those who have died in Jesus. What we are saying is a message from the Lord. We who are alive and still around at the Lord's coming definitely will go ahead of those who have died. This is because the Lord himself will come down from heaven with the signal of a shout of a head angel and a blast on God's trumpet. First, those who are dead in Christ will rise, then we who are living and still around will be taken up together with them in the clouds to meet with the Lord in the air. That way we will always be with the Lord. So encourage each other with these words. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today comes from Psalm 78, 1 through 7. Listen, my people, to my teaching. Tilt your ears toward the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth for the proverb. I will declare riddles from days gone by. Ones that we've heard and learned about, ones that our ancestors told us. We won't hide them from their descendants. We'll tell the next generation all about the praise due the Lord and his strength, the wondrous works God has done. He established a law for Jacob and set up instruction for Israel, ordering our ancestors to teach them to their children. This is so that the next generation and children not yet born will know these things, and so they can rise up and tell their children to put their hope in God, never forgetting God's deeds, but keeping God's commandments. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Finally, our gospel lesson today comes from Matthew chapter 25, verses 1 through 13. Please rise in spirit or in body for the reading of the gospel. Hear now the words of our Lord. At that time, the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 young bridesmaids who took their lamps and went out to meet the groom. Now, 5 of them were wise and the other 5 were foolish. The foolish ones took their lamps but did not bring oil for them. But the wise ones took their lamps and also brought containers of oil. When the groom was late in coming, they all became drowsy and went to sleep. But at midnight there was a cry. Look, the groom, come out to meet him. Then all those bridesmaids got up and prepared their lamps. But the foolish bridesmaids said to the wise ones, give us some of your oil because our lamps have gone out. But the wise bridesmaids replied, no, because if we share with you, there won't be enough for our lamps and yours. We have a better idea. You go to those who sell oil and buy some for yourselves. But while they were gone to buy oil, the groom came. And those who were ready went with him into the wedding. Then the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaids came and said, Lord, Lord, open the door for us. But he replied, I tell you the sun directly above you. But I have never been hotter in my life. I felt very much like one of the foolish bridesmaids in this, for saying yes at that moment. I should have just stayed home. And of course, the unity candle kept blowing out during the service, which was also one of those moments where I thought somebody should have lost some oil. And of course, the wedding was delayed, and so the groomsmen were all just kind of standing out there and waiting. We really just should have known at that point we needed to pack up and go home. Waiting is it's a difficult thing. I'm sure that many of you, speaking of college as a political science major in college, many of you have probably spent much of this week waiting. I have refreshed CNN and the AP website several times this week. But look, on Tuesday, I got up, woke up, and I walked to my polling place. It's only about a mile away. It was a beautiful day. Didn't think I'd have any, there'd be any parking on Belhaven's campus. So I walked. And I saw other people that I knew in the neighborhood walking, and we waved at each other, and we stood in line. We did our part for democracy. We voted. I don't know how they voted. They don't know how I voted, but that's okay. We did our part. And we started waiting. We started waiting to see what the results would be. And in some ways, let's face it, we're still kind of waiting. But I think we've all learned something about waiting this week. I think we've all learned something a little bit about doing our part. And as I was waiting, started reading these scriptures and preparing a sermon. And oddly enough, I felt like they were pretty consistent with what was going on. It's almost like scripture actually has something to say to what's going on in the world. Imagine that. 1 Thessalonians, our first New Testament reading today, is dealing with the delayed return of Christ. The early Christians believed that Christ would be returning soon, within their lifetime. And 1 Thessalonians is written to the second and third generation Christians as they watched the first generation of Christians died. And they wondered what that meant for them, for their mothers and their fathers and their grandmothers and their grandfathers and those that had discipled them into the faith. I know we're, again, about to do a Bible study of Revelation, and I want, read 1 Thessalonians, these passages. This is not about what's kind of commonly become known in the last 150, 200 years as the rapture. That's not what 1 Thessalonians is about. This is about a fear that God would have forgotten those who have died, that God had abandoned them. And the author of Thessalonians uses the image of a Roman Parousia is the name. And the Roman Parousia is when a dignitary, a representative from the emperor, would come to a city. And when the emperor came, or when the emperor or the representative came to a city, all of the city, especially the nobles, but all of the city would gather at the gates and would rush out to meet this person. up from the dead. And the author of Thessalonians is using kind of that image, except from God's point of view, that Christ would be coming just like the emissary of the emperor, who would be coming from heaven, and so we would meet him the same way we would meet the governor, the senator, the emperor. But it won't just be you, the author says. It won't just be you. It will also be all of those who've gone before. You're waiting, and they're waiting. Going to require waiting, Jesus is telling his disciples. And he gives them this parable about a wedding feast. And in this wedding feast, the groom, for some reason, is delayed. It doesn't give us a reason why. We just know that the groom is delayed. And so, 10 bridesmaids, in the very literal sense of word, they are maidens who have been chosen to represent the bride. They are at the gate waiting to let the groom in to his chambers, to let him into the feast, to begin the celebration of the wedding. And these attendants, these bridesmaids, these young women, they are waiting and waiting. And Jesus says, all 10 of them, 5 were foolish and 5 were wise, because 5 of them brought enough oil, and 5 didn't. Of course, the oil was from the lamps that they are holding that keep burning. They're waiting, and the groom is late, and so they fall asleep, and their lights go out. 5 of the bridesmaids, they just pick out their little black foil and put more in there. And the other 5 say, well, can we borrow yours? Can you lend us some of yours? And the ones Jesus calls wise says, no. No, you can't. Because then none of us will have enough. We don't know when he's coming. What if we split this up and we light our lamps again and they go out and nobody has any lights and the groom shows absolutely can hold one another up and encourage each other in the faith. But sometimes, we are waiting for someone else to do our faith for us. We're waiting for someone else to make this faith real for us. But that's not how it works. You cannot depend on your pastor to do your faith for you, your parents to do your faith for you, your friends, your church members, anyone else. We are called, all of us as Christians, to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. There is no outsourcing our relationship with God. There is no outsourcing our faith. We have to be part of this ourselves. No one can fill your role within the church for you. No one can fill your role in this world for you. Only you can do that. God has given each and every one of us a mission. God has given each and every one of us a role to play in the kingdom of God. God has given each and every one of us a mission to be part of while we wait. While we wait for God to make all things new. And as we take part in this mission, we find out that we are taking part in making all things new, in reconciling the world, in making this world a little bit better of a place, in making this world something that resembles just a little bit more the kingdom of God. We are waiting for Christ to bring his kingdom, but we cannot fall asleep on the job. We have to keep our lights on. We have to do our part. We may be waiting for Christ, and we are waiting, but we can't wait. We cannot wait to walk in the way of Christ. We have to do that now. We have to love our enemies now. Now. Whether they have personally slighted us or they are our political enemies, we have to love them. We have to feed the hungry now. We have to work for justice now. We have to get involved in our church now. We have to be serious about our faith now. We have to start that ministry that is on our hearts now. No one else is going to do it for us. We have to do what God has put on each and every one of our hearts now. No one else is going to do that for us. They can't. They've got their own mission. Each and every person, they have their own thing that God has called them to do, and so each and every one of us have to do the thing that God has called us to do. There's no waiting for that. No one else can do it for us. No one else can do it for us. God has given this to us. God has given your part. So we can't wait anymore. We wait with hope that Christ will come and make all things new, but in the meantime, we have to do what God has called us to do. We have to wake up. We have to keep alert. We don't know the hour of Christ's return. We don't know when Christ is coming. We don't know. But what we do know, this moment, right now, this moment is the time to do God's work. This moment is the time to serve God. This moment is the time to love our neighbors as we love ourselves. This is the moment. This is the moment. In the name of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray now for the needs of the world, saying, Jesus Christ, who came to redeem us. His resurrection is our promise of eternal life. By the power of your Spirit, you claim us, strengthen us, and prepare us to live with you in glory. Ensure and certain hope, we pray for your world, that we may live into your coming reign of justice and peace. For the church, wherever it thrives and wherever it struggles, keep us faithful to your gospel. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For those who govern, grant them wisdom and a commitment to justice. We pray especially this morning for our nation, for those who have put themselves forward to hold positions of leadership. We pray for our president-elect, Joe Biden, our vice president-elect, Kamala Harris. We pray for our current president, Donald Trump, our current Vice President Mike Pence. We pray for all of those who are placed in positions of administration and all of those who will be soon. We pray for those who have won their races for Senate, House of Representatives, for those who have kept their positions and those who will soon be entering into new ones. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For planet Earth, heal its wounds and make us better stewards of its wonders and gifts. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For those who are dying, calm all fears, welcome them into your peace. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For those who suffer from anxieties and ills, give them relief. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For those who endure the days and nights without food or shelter, feed and protect them. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For those who suffer in silence, comfort those who carry secret sorrows. Eternal God, hear our prayer. For all who seek your face, Eternal God, hear our prayer. With thanks that you hear our prayers, spoken and unspoken, we entrust all of life to you, gracious God, our Alpha and Omega, our only hope in life and in death. Through Jesus Christ, we pray this and the prayer that